Hey everybody, this is the Lego Hidden Side Newbury Haunted High School. I've thought about how I would even approach this review, and I think I'm going to go with the exact opposite of my initial instinct. I'll actually start with the big reveal, showing how this somewhat normal, though old and run-down high school building becomes haunted and shows its ghost possession. Later in the video, I will also show you what the augmented reality app game looks like. There are five main physical components to the ghost possession, how it works with this, plus a couple of extra little things. And most are activated around the back of the building. So one thing I'll do is push in the stairs right here at the base. And around the front, that just opens up the mouth or mouths of the place. These are just stickers on door panels or large window panels. And the bright spring green color for the teeth you see above and below, also on the stickers and many other places that we will see in this building, do not glow in the dark, and they don't really respond to UV light. They just look really bright in the day or in the light. For the next spooky thing, I'm going to push in over here on the bathroom area and over here on this bookcase. You can see how these are kind of loose. They're actually actuators that do things at the front. Watch what happens. I actually have to do one at a time, but there's one and there's the other. So the claws come out quite literally, again with a bright spring green color, and these appear to be spring-loaded. They just have one rubber band for each. You can see the little yellow band right there. And the claws were folded up inside here. So that was like that, and it just got pushed out. And you can actually open this up from the front if you want. You don't need to push in the thing from the back, but if you get just a little bit of purchase on it, then the claws will just spring out like that. There we go. So now we've got a mouth or mouths. We've got hands, and then we definitely need some eyes to help complete the look of this being a full, almost anthropomorphized thing. You actually get the eyes to come out by using the clock on the front, so you don't need to go around the back of the model for this whatsoever. You just rotate the clock. I think it's clockwise. Nope, counterclockwise. There we go. Yeah, and the eyes come out. And those have one sticker on each of the upper tiles. The rest of that is, you know, the rest of what you see there is physically built up. So that's almost completing the look, but there's more that you can do. Now, these parts up here, you can change either up top or from the front. Doesn't really matter. So here I'm just going to rotate this back. Something fell out. We'll take a look at that later on, but you can see little bits of I don't know what that's supposed to be. It's like mist. It's like ghostly mist. It's a little bit neon, a little bit fluorescent looking. It's weird. It's actually a translucent neon greenish yellow color. And then there's the same thing over here. Again, something fell out. We'll see what that is a little bit later on. But, you know, this is bringing more in, more different details in to the transformation. So you're seeing more and more of the greenish color. And then over here on the side, I'm just going to move the bench back. Actually, I thought I had to move the whole thing, but actually need to do it from the base. Rotate that up, and there's another face with four eyes in it, and it's a chomping jaw. So if you were sitting right there, well, first of all, hopefully you felt it starting to transform and you ran forward, and I could just imagine this kind of chasing after you, you know, like little chomping jaws. But it doesn't move on the whole, but, you know, it's one way to think of it. There's another thing that you can just barely start to see through the window there in the center. It looks like it's a bright green colored teddy bear, but it's very difficult to open the window from this side at all. To get to that, we're coming around the back once again, and here there's kind of a handle. You lift this up. It's a bell that was previously hanging from above that appears to have fallen. If you put the bell back, it unlocks a swinging panel right here where there's the blackboard that can actually rotate around, and then that shows you the haunted teddy bear, and obviously the previous owner of that teddy bear, who I'm assuming is now a ghost. And there's another clue behind here as to who that is. And the teddy bear itself is definitely pretty spooky and or sad looking. No print around the back of this one, but it is unique for this theme. All right, so now that you've seen the whole school fully haunted, I will change it back, hopefully in real time, to show you just how much of a difference it makes between the two forms of it, between seeing it fully haunted like that and having it not so. So it doesn't really take that long. I'm going to just pull that from the other side, fold this back in right there, get it to click, and bring that down. And that's that. It's back to its normal form. I'm happy that you don't see a whole lot of clues from the outside about all those transformative features. I mean, there is a lot of detail here, and you will see some little bits, like you already can see a little bit of the bright green, you know, sticking out over there. But there are a lot of details that are just intended to make the place look spooky in more of a normal, realistic way, you know, where it's just an old place and, you know, has a slightly gothic edge to its architecture. Well, more than slightly, probably, with some of the spikes and some of the decorations. I don't think we've gotten these pieces previously in gray, and also these gazebo have parts. I think we have not gotten in gray. Don't quote me on that, but I personally haven't seen them in that color before, and I think that it works really nicely, much better than sticking with an existing color for this new building. And again, you can see a little bit, especially if you turn to the sides, you see a little bit on the inside of the stairway there. I think, you know, if that bothers you too much, leave out the lower teeth. I think they're the main things that are obvious from any kind of distance, just because of how bright that material is. I think that the stickers are normally in shadow enough that you don't see them all that much. But see, there's a lot of detail out here that I think it makes it look just like a rundown but fairly realistic building. There are a lot of stickers, though. A lot of these details are done with stickers. As a matter of fact, let me go ahead and show you the two sticker sheets, the two spent sticker sheets for this set. It's actually better to show you after the stickers are taken off so you can see all the outlines. This is just one of the sheets. Here's the other one. That's a lot of stickers. I haven't counted them up because there are some duplicates in there. You have to count them. But yeah, it's a lot. And it really felt excessive to me as I put this together, the number of stickers that were required for this. If you don't like stickers, I'm afraid you might not like this set because it does rely on them. It's not just about small details that add a little bit of texture. There's a lot of important stuff that only comes through via the stickers, and you'll see that around the back. So let's go ahead and start from the top. This is supposed to be the interior space, and yeah, a lot of detail, a lot of small things, but a lot of stickers. Once again, got the periodic table back there. You got some beakers. This is supposed to be chemistry lab, I think, over here. Little hall of trophies. Just enough room there is here to put figures along the edge, and they can be facing away from you or towards you or kind of side by side, but or side to side. But you do need to move a hand out of the way, an arm out of the way, to get them to pose properly in these places, to be walking along what's supposed to be the hallway, but then turns into interior space. Like, this is supposed to be the back of the classroom, but then you have all the seats here, which do have enough room for one figure each, with room for arms on either side as well. But they're supposed to be facing towards the blackboard, obviously. I guess I could angle that a little bit. You know, you have to use your imagination in terms of figuring out the spatial arrangement of this. You know, bend time and space a little bit in your mind to get it to work out. But just look at how many stickers, again, are used and are really necessary to make this feel complete, to make this feel right. Even the computer screen back there actually uses a sticker. I'm actually okay with that because it's showing that some research is being done regarding that haunted teddy bear. You know, I think that kind of makes some sense back there. And there is, again, a spot for a figure to be able to sit or stand. Standing is preferable for that. Yeah, that takes care of pretty much the upper level. Let's go downstairs now. This is intended to be the library. Okay. Yeah, it's not much of a library, is it? Moving right along. Got a, is this cafe? No, I think this is still part of the library over here. I was thinking cafeteria? No, it's just, they've got a map of Newbury there. So trying to figure out where the center of the haunting energy is in the town, connecting sites of different specific incidents of haunting and strange paranormal activity. That's actually a print that they did before, but then the gear work down below is done with a sticker. Another sticker there, print for the pizza. They actually have a couple of I'm assuming probably maybe refrigerated, maybe not. Just fruit down there. You see the cherry and the banana. You can't really get to those very easily, but you know, it's supposed to be the cafeteria. It's supposed to be where you get your food from. I don't know how somebody's supposed to be back there serving, but I guess it's just on the table. That's it. And you got a cart here that you can roll around. It has a spot for it to stay. No place to really sit and eat, though. And then they have the bathroom, which is just a single exposed stall. That's definitely the smallest space that you could use to create a bathroom. Does not even have a sink in it. Where are the kids going to wash their hands? Come on. Come on. At least they have a plunger. I guess the plumbing is not very good here. I'm not surprised by that, given how old the place is. And that's it. So, in its non-haunted form, the building looks not particularly haunted. It just looks old. So I think they did a pretty good job of hiding away most of the stuff that's related to the hidden side of it all. You do see a little bit of the bright spring green showing through. But overall, you know, this could be dropped into a city easily. You can leave out just a few parts and you could drop this into a city, a town, and forget about the whole haunting aspect of it and just use it as a building, you know, without doing any major transformation to it, to adapt it. The sad thing is that it does use up a lot of space for its haunting features. Like all of this right here, the entire thickness of this is used up just for those claws to be able to fold up back in there. And that's the reason why the library is just basically flush with the wall. You just have a single bookcase there. You don't have any extra depth. So definitely a lot of the bulk of this, a lot of the mass, a lot of the parts went into hiding away some of the stuff that's hidden side specific. These are the two things that fell out of the attic when I was doing the transformation. So you see that they're just some texts that are related to unraveling the mystery of Lady E, you know, looking for the teddy bear and understanding how you can switch around the portrait and, you know, just looking for ways to expose what's really going on. You can also study those in the library because the library has a couple of clips down there. I'm not actually going to clip it on, but you know, that's just a place where you can set it up, and you can also turn it around to expose the color, which I'm assuming will be useful for the app we will see later on. Figures. Here are Jack and Parker. They have a couple of variants each throughout this theme. I believe that these are both my favorite variants for these characters. I like the torso piece for Parker on this one, actually, and for Jack. Yeah, I like both of these setups in total. I think that these are interesting looking figures in all of their forms, but I just personally prefer these. And they're printed up pretty well. They look unique, and they're not completely tied to hidden side either. Like, these could just turn into regular kids over time if you don't want to use them specifically for this theme. You get tired of this theme, you know, you just want to integrate them with other things. It definitely works. And they have the new molds for the headgear, which are dual molded, and each one has an alternate face. Here we have Paola and Wade. Now, these two do have torsos that are somewhat hidden side specific, but I think as long as you just think of the city or town of Newbury as being part of the general Lego minifigure world canon, you can still think of these as being outside of the hidden side world, whether you want to imagine that there's no ghost possession going on whatsoever, or if just Newbury is maybe a couple towns over from where your Lego people live. You know, these still, I think, will integrate in with regular folks. That's a really cool, really expressive new face, pair of actually new faces for Paola especially. And yeah, two more good looking figures, I think, with nice color schemes. On the left here is Mr. Clark, and on the right is Mr. Elton. He says Diaz on his nameplate, so I'm assuming it's Diaz Elton. As of the time of the recording of this video, I have not seen any official explanation of who these characters are supposed to be. I'm assuming that Mr. Clark is a science teacher of some sort, and Mr. Elton is probably a main maintenance engineer for the entire school facility. You know, he's the wise janitor.
I'm the wise janitor.
But again, I just don't know for certain. But two more interesting figures, not the greatest of print on the back of Diaz's torso there. You know, it's just relatively simple, but really good printing for Mr. Clark all the way through. Interesting faces, expressive to be sure. Again, not too specific to the world of Hidden Side. Yeah, I like those alternate faces as well. Last but not least, here on the left is Miss Rose Davids. I'm assuming she's the principal for the school slash administrator, or she could be used as a librarian, one of the teachers, a parent. I just don't know canonically what they want her to be. Certainly you can, you know, give her whatever role that you like. I personally would choose to use her as the principal. Just, you know, looks very formally dressed like that. And then of course there's the helpful ghost dog named Spencer, has a single anti-stud on the underside, so it looks like it floats just a little bit above the ground and is made dual molded with marble together trans clear and just regular white. There is also an alternate face for this figure to look scared. And this is the type of thing that figures in this set would be scared of, becoming possessed by ghosts. So they do have some alternate heads and hair pieces with some dual molded hair going on there to show possessions of individual figures. So this is just one of them here. Wanted to show you all the details, including some printing around the back. Here's a haunting set for Mr. Clark. And this comes with also that set of ghost wings, sort of ghost body, ghost shoulder blades. What is that? Translucent neon greenish yellow color. They actually have two of those in the set. Notice the different mold for the hair there. That is not dual molded hair, it's just the single bright spring green color. And there's a little bit more of the print for that one. Also, again, print around the back of the head. And even the kids can be possessed in this. I don't know how I feel about that. I think that pushes things a little bit into being too scary for some younger potential customers, potential owners of sets like this. You know, it's one thing to have that little bit of realm of safety, a little bit of buffer where, you know, it's only the adults who risk being possessed and then they'll chase after you. But if you yourself as a kid can get possessed, that just seems super, super scary, especially, like I said, just for some of the younger kids. But this does show that in this world, it is possible. So it's something to look out for. If you don't like the idea, then just don't do it, you know? But Lego is definitely very directly suggesting this. I don't think that was the greatest idea, just my personal opinion. The leftover or spare parts for the set, as usual, include one of each of the smallest of items. I appreciate getting an extra one of these and also a couple of the unicorn horns, one in silver, one in gold over there, some all sorts of interesting one-by-one pieces. But then there's this, the elephant in the room, the 1x6x1 white brick. That's not supposed to be there. That's a mistake. It was something that was very annoying. Happens every once in a while. But when it does happen, it sucks. I got an extra one of these instead of one of these. So I was missing one of these. Fortunately, I had an extra in my own collection. I had to remove a sticker from it because it already had a sticker on it. But Lego does make mistakes every once in a while. This is why they have the replacement parts service. From what I've heard from folks and from what I've personally experienced, they're pretty good about replacing parts. But of course, that doesn't help you when you are building something and you have an extra of the wrong piece and you're missing something that you need. But yeah, mistakes do happen even with Lego. All right, checking out the free downloadable augmented reality app for Hidden Side for mobile phones and tablets. The integration for this particular set is better than on the smaller sets that I've reviewed up to this point. I've not gone through the entire series just yet, so I don't have all of the experience, but definitely there's a lot more going on with this one than with the others. The same basic play pattern remains, where you scan the set in and it adds a bunch of background around it to really make it feel more immersive, but there's still a limited amount of stuff that you can physically do. Like if you try to put a minifigure into some of the space, you know, physically in real life into some of the space where they've projected the digital background, you won't be able to see the minifigure at all. The digital stuff goes over it. So the only physical stuff that you see in the app is within the confines, within the borders of the main school build, and they show you specific places where they allow you to change things. And you just go around and you scan for things. You're looking for what they call gloom, and ultimately you find different upgrades that will help you later on, and commodities that can be used to spend towards upgrades and such. And you also look for ghosts, and you find those specific ghosts hidden in different places, and you have a little shooting game with them, and you try to take them out and prevent them from glooming you up and draining your battery in the process. With this one, there is one place where you can change the color, the little rotating thing next to the stairs in the back, or you change the color and it just basically changes the sub-element of paranormal energy that you're scanning for. It's just one little bit of physical interaction. There are some prompts occasionally during the gameplay where they will want you to place a minifigure from the set on a specific point, on a specific pedestal somewhere around, and it doesn't matter what minifigure you put there and whether that minifigure has a ghost possession set of pieces on it or not, the app will determine, I think it's basically at random, whether or not there is a ghost actually possessing that figure at the time. And if there is one, then you go into the same sort of battle scenario again, and it works pretty much the same as with the others. Different ghosts have different movement patterns and also different ways that they will shoot different forms of gloom and different types of projectile weapons at you, and those projectiles will move different ways also. Now, one additional thing that is very good that this does is allow you to get into converting the building itself over to the possessed form. They actually have you push in the bathroom and the library in order to get to some colors that are hidden down below, which will confirm to the app that you have done that, that you've taken another step to physically transform the building. And the colors that are hidden beneath there are the ones that are on the undersides of the hidden texts that we found in the attic, or the attics. And generally that's in a shaded space, so what you can do is actually use the pieces from the attics as substitutes, place those in there, and basically trick the app into thinking that it's looking at the pieces that are actually built in to the structure there. I think that's just a good substitution. And even better than that, this is a set that actually asks you to turn the entire thing around to get to the boss fight. The boss fight is against a set-specific boss. Mr. Nibs is the ghostly 800-pound gorilla version of the teddy bear, and they do want you to turn the entire set around in order to have that boss fight. So that's nice, you know, some more actual physical interaction that gets you around more of the model, which is something that you don't necessarily do or even have the ability to effectively do with some of the smaller hidden side sets. All the parts of the app experience that directly integrate with the set and have you looking at the set want you to be in a vertical orientation, but they also have a horizontal orientation part that works offline that doesn't require that you even have any of the sets. You can just download the app and play it yourself. Speaking of which, make sure if you want to take advantage of all the augmented reality interactions with any of these sets that you get the app first, or at least check on the LEGO device compatibility website whether your device is compatible with this specific app, because not all devices are. If you have anything that's a little bit too old, a little bit underpowered, it is possible that the app won't be able to be downloaded at all. So you can just check that. Even if you aren't interested in buying any of these sets and you have just a little bit of interest in seeing what the app is like and playing one half of its experience, just download it, just check it out. It's free. There are no microtransactions, no in-app purchases whatsoever, so there are no catches whatsoever. You don't even need to log into a Safe LEGO Life account to use it. You can just use it as a plain, traditional, offline app. Newbury Haunted High School goes for $130 US and comes with 1,474 pieces, giving it a pretty amazing price-to-part ratio, honestly, and it looks like in some other countries it is at least equally good, especially relative to the normal differences in prices from region to region. So I think the value is good here on that basis. But more importantly, the volume of stuff that you get for that price is also very good, relative especially to other LEGO sets that have been made in a similar price range recently. I think that the build of the building itself is good. It's nice and solid. There's a lot of detail, definitely way too many stickers on this thing. But at least as a physical product, you can play all around it. I personally definitely would have preferred having less of the really interesting, deeply integrated haunting stuff here. I think that a lot of pieces and a lot of effort goes into building that stuff up for not a lot of reward. I think maybe if the claws were actually on arms where you could then move them beyond that, beyond just having them go up and down, where it would really look like the whole building is moving and trying to catch the kids and faculty and everything, that would be a little bit more interesting, because that would actually give you more of a physical, direct, repeatable play pattern, something that you could do a little bit longer term than just having it flip open. I feel like that can get old pretty quickly. If you could actually pick them up, then I think that would be more interesting. As it is, I think that some of that build, some of that complexity could have gone into providing a little bit more depth for the non-haunted experience, or just depth in general, and more spaces for interaction. If you want to see all about how the entire set goes together, including its interior details and the build details of the structure, check out my speed build or the real-time pure build version of that. I will link to both of those on screen here momentarily. The speed build is just your traditional time-lapse style, and the pure build is the same thing without being sped up whatsoever, so you can actually see in real time how it goes. It's something that's useful to put on just maybe in the background, and have running, because it is rather long. So thank you in advance for checking out one of those. If you do, thanks for stopping by this review, and I'll talk to you again as soon as I can.